Good morning.
Good morning.
And this is not a delusion, you're not dreaming. My wife's at a meeting in Penmark, so she's asked me to start the service. And I'm in my regalia because I'm now officially starting my training as a lay reader. Thank you. Thank you. It's only been 12 months late, but hey, it was better late than never, eh? Right, we shall start our service with our first hymn, which is Lord of Creation, to you be all praise. Together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace be with you.
And keep you in the love of Christ.
Father of glory,
holy and eternal, look upon us now in power and mercy. May your strength overcome our weakness, your radiance transform our blindness, and your Spirit draw us to that love shown and offered to us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please sit. In a moment's silence, let's call to mind the past week. Let's think of the times where we've not done what we ought to have done, where we've not said the things we should have said. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let's say it together. Heavenly Father,
we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light. Amen.
Almighty God, and forgive us all who truly repent, have mercy on us, and set us free from sin. Strengthen us in goodness, and keep us in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Now stand to sing the Gloria. Trinity 8. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We'll now have a reading from Job.
Good morning. Today's readings are from the end of Job. It's the last three chapters of Job. Chapter 38, which is on page 538, we're reading verses 1 to 18, then we jump over to verse 40, and then we read 1 to 14, and then over again to 42, where we read 1 to 6. So starting on page 538, we starting off at chapter 38, verses 1 to 18. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge. Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? Excuse me. When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no farther. Here, here is where your proud waves halt. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place, that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under the seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the deepest darkness? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. And over to chapter 40. The Lord said to Job, will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him. Then Job answered the Lord, I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but I have no answer twice. But I will say no more. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Would you discredit my justice? Would you condemn me to justify yourself? Do you have an arm like God's, and can your voice thunder like his? Then adorn yourself with glory and splendor, and clothe yourself in honor and majesty. Unleash the fury of your wrath. Look at all who are proud and bring them low. Look at all who are proud and humble them. Crush the wicked where they stand. Bury them in the dust together. Shroud their eyes in the grave. Then I myself will admit to you that your own right hand can save you. And finally, chapter 42. Then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is that that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Alan. And we'll be coming back to that in the sermon. So keep your Bibles open. Now let's sing. I give you all the honour.
Thank you.
let's stand for the gospel reading. Our gospel this morning is Luke chapter 12. I can't remember the verse numbers. Verse 32 to 40, which can be found on page 1044 of the Pew Bibles. Okay, 1045. Jesus said, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed ready for service and keep your lamps burning, like servants waiting for their masters to return from a wedding banquet, so that when he comes and knocks, they can immediately open the door for him. It will be good for those servants whose master finds them watching when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will dress himself to serve, will make them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them. It will be good for those servants whose master finds them ready, even if he comes in the middle of the night or towards daybreak. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." I apologize, I forgot the responses, didn't I? This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. And we pray, Lord, now that you'll be with us. Open our hearts and our minds to what you have to teach us from these chapters of Job. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as many of you know, if not all, my daughter wants to be a vet when she grows up. Which reminded me of when I was a child, there was a program on TV called All Creatures Great and Small. Some of you may well have watched it, based on the life of James Herriot and his training in life as a vet. Now, in his book, All Creatures Great and Small, James Herriot tells a story of when he was 17 years old and the day he became humbled. It was day 3 of veterinary training, and he'd had a wonderful lecture that morning by a very gifted professor on animal husbandry, in particular on horses. And he came out of that lecture thinking, "I now know everything there is to know about horses." So the first thing he did is, as any 17-year-old kid would do, I suppose, he went into town and bought himself a brand new riding mack. And as he came out of the shop, the buckles banging against his leg, he felt the bee's knees. And what did he see when he came out of the shop? Well, across the road was a big, massive horse, and stationary, and behind it was a coal cart. He thought, this is the moment. So he wandered over and stood in front of the horse and just gazed at it. And in his mind, he was going through all the anatomy and physiology of the horse, all he'd learnt that morning, and the passers-by just passed by. They just ignored him completely. And then after he finished his inspection of this magnificent beast, he turned away. But before doing so, he thought, "I'll give the horse a sign of my gratitude, something he'd like." So he went to pat the horse on the neck. Unfortunately, the horse had other ideas, because what the horse did was clamp onto James's arm, lifted him off the ground, and so he hung there, in midair, according to James's account, like a lopsided puppet. This definitely got the people's attention, as a crowd now formed, with him hanging there. And to make matters worse, young ladies in the crowd were giggling, which added further to his embarrassment. Some old ladies were saying, "Help, help, this man needs help." And the horse began to salivate onto James's face as he hung there. And to make matters worse, the new coat he bought started to restrict his breathing. So just then, in the nick of time, a little old guy came bursting through the crowd, took one look at the horse, and told the horse to drop him. The horse hesitated, So the little man went up and stuck his thumb in the horse's stomach, at which point the horse let go of James and he flopped to the floor, gasping for air. Immediately, once he got his breath back, he decided this was the moment he really needed to get out of this situation very quickly. So he went to make a hasty retreat, but not before he heard the old man say to him and the crowd in a loud voice, and I will spare you an appallingly bad Scottish accent at this point. The translation would read, don't meddle with things you know nothing about. Or as James wrote in his book, it starts with dinner and ends in a boot. Now this is virtually the same lesson Job is about to learn from God in these closing chapters of the book. The section we're looking at today can be divided into two speeches of God and two of Job's responses. Now throughout the book, Job has consistently asked for an audience with God to find out why he is suffering as he is. His friends have consistently argued that it is because he has sinned and needs to repent. And for three rounds of speeches, each of his friends have stated similar things, with the main point being that Job has done something wrong and needs to ask God for forgiveness. Then last week, we were introduced to the enigmatic Elihu, who spoke of God as speaking when he's not silent, that God is just and he shows no partiality, and indeed he listens to a mediator and accepts a ransom so that God will restore a transgressor. And Elihu concluded his speeches by announcing that God is coming, and he's coming in a storm. And now in chapter 38, we finally meet God himself, speaking to Job out of a storm. Now the first thing to note is that this is a personal meeting between God in the storm and Job in his suffering. Now we know from scripture that God speaks in different ways to his people, a burning bush to Moses, a still voice to Elijah, in a vision to Isaiah, and ultimately through the person of his one and only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yet here, God chooses to demonstrate his greatness and power by speaking from a storm, and yet does so in private to his servant Job. God states at the outset, chapter 38, verse 2, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me." Throughout the book, for 37 chapters, Job has been demanding an audience with God. He's charged to God, as explicitly stated in chapter 27, verse 1, "God who has denied me justice." Yet what is striking here is that God does not enter the dock to plead his case before Judge Job, but rather begins interrogation of Job with a series of over 70 questions. His first one coming in verse 4, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations?" The answer is clear that Job had not even been born. And the implication is apparent. Who are you to question my ways? Yet isn't this our innate response when tragedy befalls us? Don't we ask God why and put him in the dock of our interrogation so he can justify himself to us? We so easily forget that we are not God and we don't have the right to justify ourselves before him. In asking all of these questions, God nowhere charges Job with any sins which have resulted in his present suffering, which is what his friends have constantly argued. But what God does do is demonstrate clearly what answers are not acceptable in God's universe. And Job, like us, we're not to question God about the world we live in. For we do not know the sources from where the universe began. We do not know the systems upon which the earth depends. We don't even appreciate the speciality by which animals are distinguished. In chapters 38 and 39, God names a variety of animals. We've got lions, donkeys, goats, wild ox, an ostrich, horse, hawk, eagle, even a raven. And the questions are similar. "Do you make it leap?" asked the God of Job. Or, in case of the eagle, "Does the eagle soar at your command?" And the answer is clearly resounding no. God God concludes his first speech with the following words in chapter 40. The Lord said to Job, "Will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him." And Job's response is brief and succinct. "I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but I had no answer. Twice, but I will say no more." Job has been stunned into silence at God's questions. He's both unworthy and unknowing. When we are confronted with the majesty of God and the world he has created, we can do no more than do what Job has done here: admit our sinfulness and say nothing. Then God carries on with his second speech. Chapter 40, verse 8 and 9. God asked Job, "Would you discredit my justice? Would you condemn me to justify yourself? Do you have an arm like God's, and can your voice thunder like his?" One commentator has paraphrased these four questions from God as follows: "Do you refute my wisdom? Do you condemn my justice? Do you doubt my power? Do you reject my voice?" In each of these questions, the issue is God's power, and the principle which Job must deal with is God's justice. These are clearly exemplified in his descriptions of the Leviathan and of Behemoth. Now, these two creatures have been identified by some commentators as a crocodile and a hippopotamus, respectively. However, Leviathan is clearly more than a crocodile. In the description, he's both massive and powerful. He breathes fire. And God asked Job, "Can you catch this magnificent beast with a fishhook?" Well, clearly he can't. Now, Leviathan is also mentioned previously in Job in chapter 3, where Job speaks of his wish to have never been born and cites Leviathan as being summoned by those who curse. Elsewhere in Scripture, Leviathan is described as a serpent who is the enemy of God's people and who God will slay in Isaiah 27 verse 1 and God will crush in Psalm 74 verse 14. God's point in these descriptions is also clear. If Job is able to demonstrate a position of superior justice to God, and he can justly charge God with injustice. However, he can only do this if he's able to subdue these great beasts, Leviathan and Behemoth, and the cosmic forces which wage war against God, which they represent. Now, Job clearly cannot subdue these beasts, and neither can we. Indeed, Scripture is clear that the only one who can is God himself. In the cosmic courtroom at the start of this book, Job told Satan, the adversary, that he can go this far and no further. And in the opening chapter 38, where God describes the waters, said the waters can go this far and no further. There are limits on the abilities which God alone sets. When we try to be God, we have no control on setting these limits. And if anyone's seen the film Bruce Almighty, you can see that this is definitely the case. Then Job finally responds in chapters 42, verse 1 to 6. Now, George Bernard Shaw once mocked God's answer to Job in these chapters. "Job wanted an answer to his suffering," said Shaw, "but the best God could do is brag about making crocodiles and snowflakes." Now, this answer assumes that God owes us an explanation, with the presumption that explanations to us are preferable to us worshipping and trusting in Almighty God. Now, Job's response in chapter 42 shows us that he felt nothing like what Shaw alluded to. Job now realizes that God is powerful. Verse 2, "I know that you can do all things." And Job has also come to realize that he spoke from a place of ignorance. Verse 3, "Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know." But now that wonder has transformed his faith. Verse 5, "My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." Job has now seen the Lord, and And in so doing, he no longer asks questions or seeks answers. He simply repents. When we come face to face with the living God, we will be like Job and Isaiah before him, For God is holy and we are sinners. Yet because of Jesus, we will not perish. The believer will learn from Job to look beyond this life, not for answers, which we may not even get even in heaven, but for the Redeemer, who has conquered death for us and will raise us up to be with him. They will remember, as Paul wrote in Romans 8, verse 18, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Then hopefully they will learn that it is better to know God and trust God than to demand answers from God. Let us pray. Dear Living Father, we thank you that you are majestic and sovereign, that all things are in your hands. We thank you that you are powerful and beyond our infinite dreams or imagination. Dear Lord, we are sorry when we belittle you and reduce you to our own image, or when we seek to demand answers from you, as if you were just there to just alleviate and massage our egos. Father, always help us to remember that you are the awesome God, the mighty God, the God of wonder, who created all things. And help our response to be one, like it is in Revelation, of just singing your praises, for you are worthy. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we stand and affirm our faith with the words of the Creed?
I believe and trust in God the Father, who created all that exists. I believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
And now Liz will come lead us in our prayers.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we ask you to hear our prayers today for your church, the world, our local community, and people in particular need. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Everlasting God, we pray for all Christians around the world. We particularly ask for your protection for Christians who are persecuted because of their faith, and your blessing for all organisations and individuals that seek to help them. We pray for our parish of Penmark, Porthcurry and Roos. We ask for your guidance for Melanie, Rhiannon, Gavin, Darren and all others who are involved in ministering to our congregations in any way. May they always be aware of the blessings you bestow on them. Strengthen and uphold them when they grow weary in their work. We ask for your blessing on our parish as we seek to create a church community that welcomes visitors and strangers and provides help and nourishment to people in every type of need. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Creator God, we come to you now with heavy hearts when we look at the mess we are making of your world. We hold before you our broken and hurting world. People fearful and anxious, a world of hunger and pain, a world of grief and anger, a world where conflicts abound, where twisted ideologies and misguided beliefs, a world where leaders appear more concerned about serving their own interests than those of the people they are called to represent and serve. We pray for our world in its diversity, its random colours and shapes, sizes and personalities. We pray for the good of your love, the blessing of your presence, and the power of your Spirit to come. We pray for all those people, places and situations that need peace, justice, equality, hope and love, and ask that you would show us how to help through our words and actions. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Faithful God, we pray for our local community and ask that you show us how we can best reach out to people in need. We ask you to bring families along to the Play Cafe tomorrow and rejoice in the continued support for the cafe on Tuesdays. We also pray for the staff and pupils of our local schools, that they will enjoy their holidays and come back refreshed in September. We bring before you those young people awaiting exam results. We pray for all those who are on holiday or preparing to go. Pray for Melanie as she leads the group visiting Oberammergau, some of whom are strangers to her. Keep those travelling safe wherever they go. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Loving God, we pray for all those suffering with illness in body, mind or spirit. We ask you to give strength and guidance to all those who try to help them. In a moment of silence, we name those people we are particularly concerned about today. We ask that all those mentioned will be touched by your healing hand and feel your peace and presence alongside them every step of their journey. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Merciful God, we pray for those who are mourning the death of someone close and dear to them, either recently or at this time of year. We thank you for those who have travelled before us on the way of the cross and are now at peace in your eternal presence. Help us to live always mindful of your promise that the road of faith will lead us to your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Help us in our own little ways to be bringers of hope and messengers of love. Help us to put aside material gain and focus on the best for the common good, to manage well all that we have and not let it become our purpose in life. May our lives reflect your glory, provide glimpses of your love, and bring little nuggets of your kingdom to the places we are and the people we meet in the coming week. So, merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's stand and share this chat of peace with each other. Now sing?
Sorry,
Darren. That's right. Yeah. I didn't know what we were going to sing for the slide. We should now sing our next hymn, It Is a Time Most Wonderful.
Thank you.
we celebrate together the gifts and grace of God.
We take this bread, we take this wine, to follow Christ's example and obey his commands.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
True and living God, the source of life for all creation, you have made us in your own image. Always and everywhere we give you thanks, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In your love for us, and in the fullness of time, you sent your Son to be the Saviour. The Word was made flesh, he lived among us, and we have seen his glory. For our sins and the sins of all the world, he suffered death on the cross. You raised him to life in triumph and exalted him in glory. Through him you send your Holy Spirit upon your church and make us your people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we praise your glorious name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Bendigedig oedd tyddiw hoff a lliog, a fe'r arglwydd Iesu, a nos a brydwch oedd ef, gymryd bara, ac wedi rhoi diolch i ti, fe torol, a'i rhoi i'w ddisgyblu yn y dweud, cymerwch bwytaw, hwn i fy hoff a roddi drosom, fel hyn e'r cof amdano. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen, Christ will come in glory.
Therefore, loving God, recalling now the sacrifice of Christ your Son, once for all upon the cross, and the triumph of his resurrection, we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that we may be fed with the body and blood of your Son, and be filled with your life and goodness. Unite us in Christ and give us your peace, that we may do your work and be his body in the world. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
So as our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever.
Break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, for we all share in one bread.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us. So come, let us receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith, with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious.
His love is everlasting.
Generous God, you have fed us at your heavenly table. Kindle us with the fire of your Spirit, that when the Lord comes again, we may shine as lights before him, who is alive and reigns in glory forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
So our notices. Did Darren manage okay?
Yes.
Yes, we'll give him your feedback after the service. But a word on Darren, actually. Some of you will know that he's got a new job at Aberystwyth University. So from the 5th of September, he's going to be spending Monday to Friday in Aberystwyth.
You look really sad, Darren.
And because of that, they've decided that he's going to do his placement. Well, probably not because of that, but that's my generous way of putting it. He's going to do his placement in Aberystwyth. So you won't hear him preach again for a little while, because he's going to be preaching midweek with them. So he'll be here on a Sunday, unless he's got a residential part of his course. So he will be here on a Sunday, but you won't hear him preach for a little while. So do give him some constructive feedback. It'll be wonderful, and it may be Christmas time when we're needing to spread things out. He might do something else then. So that's news on Darren. Tomorrow we've got our play cafe that will be here in church. So the cafe is only going to be open this side. Tomorrow, Tuesday, it'll only be open that side, if that makes sense. So if you want to come and have a cup of coffee, you're very welcome, even if you've not got children. It's just the children will be in here as well. If you can come and help and mingle and chat to people, that would be great. And especially if you can come at 2 o'clock and help me to put the church back ready for worship, would be really, really wonderful. So that's tomorrow. I will be away leading this group going to Oberammergau, which will include Liz and Gavin as well. So you won't see any of us next Sunday, but we're going to be in the very, very capable hands of Rhianna. So you won't really notice any difference, which will be fantastic. But we're not doing Job next week. It would have been a together service, but we're not doing it for August. So Rhianna will be preaching on the lectionary readings. And then the following week, we'll be finishing our series on Job. So do pray for me, Rhiannon and Gavin. We're meeting tomorrow night to meet together to pray, to discuss what we're going to be preaching on next. So do pray for good guidance on the next book that we'll be covering. Any other notices? We have had a birthday, haven't we?
Yeah.
How many birthdays have we had? So we have Joe and Liz. Anybody else? August is a fine month for birthdays.
It's a wonderful month for birthdays.
Well, let's sing happy birthday to Joe and to Liz.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joe and Liz. Happy birthday.
Congratulations to you both. I just thought of another notice. Sorry, really boring after that. But if it gets very dry, we'll need somebody to hose our roof with the green roof. It needs spraying. If it gets too dry, all the plants will die. So maybe if a couple of you could have a conversation with one another and see if that might be possible. If it gets, because I think it's going to get really dry and hot again for a spell. We don't want our green roof to die so quickly. We'll also show us if that roof is still leaking in the kitchen, because the contractor came and couldn't find a reason. Anyway, let's sing our final hymn, Thou Whose Almighty Word.
Thou
God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, restore, establish, and strengthen you in the faith, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with each one of you, now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.